Hi everyone, once again I am Dr. Hariharan, Professor of Biotechnology. Today in this lecture what we are going to study is about the restriction endonucleus. So before starting my lecture I want to give you a brief background what this lecture is going to all about. So while in my previous lectures we were studying about various steps involved in a gene cloning. So in that the first step is the isolation of DNA from the target cell, that we have studied in last lecture. And the second step is the cutting of the DNA with the help of an enzyme called restriction endonucleus. So today's topic is about the restriction endonucleus in detail. So in this what we are going to study is what is meant by the restriction endonucleus enzyme. Second is how many different types of vents this restriction endonucleus enzymes will create. And third is that what is meant by restriction modification system. And the final fourth one is the how the naming of this enzyme has been done currently, that is its nomenclature. Let us start with the brief introduction with this restriction endonucleus, that is the cutting of DNA. So before 1970 there was no methods were available for precisely cutting the DNA at where we actually wants to cut. So the available method at the time in 1970s were generally a physical means for cutting the DNA. This method, what is the issue is that it is not precisely cutting the DNA where we need the gene in particular. So it sometimes cuts the DNA at a non-specific location in between the genes itself, thereby we are not able to get the DNA or gene of interest for us. So until the discovery of this restriction endonucleus was possible, in 1968 there were two scientists, that is the Meselson and Yuan, were isolated an enzyme called restriction endonucleus from a bacteria called Escherichia coli K12. So this discovery was profound to be an important one, especially in the development of the rDNA technology and more precisely in the precise restriction of the DNA. So what was actually this enzymes was doing in the bacteria? What was the purpose of this restriction endonucleus to be present in the bacteria? If we go through it, what the bacteria is, this enzymes works as a defense mechanism for the bacteria against the invading the viral genetic material. So for example, if you consider a virus, that is a bacteriophage, a virus that generally infects a bacteria, what happened is that the viral, that is the bacteriophage, will infect it and it inserts its genetic material into the bacteria, then it integrates into the host cell, then finally it develops into many viral particles and causes lysis of the bacteria. So how to protect the bacteria itself, it produces an enzyme called restriction endonucleus. So what this enzyme is that it finds the origin of this incoming DNA, then destroys it by cutting at its specific location. Thereby it protects the bacteria from the infection. So this was the actually the purpose of restriction endonucleus was present in the bacteria. Then technically, once we want to put a brief definition what is meant by a restriction endonucleus, we can put it into your 2 points. That is, a restriction endonucleus is an enzyme which is recognize a specific sequence of an DNA, then cleaves means it cuts the DNA into fragments either at its specific sites or randomly. That means a restriction enzyme is a protein molecule, it's an enzyme. What it does is it identifies a specific sequence in the DNA, then cuts at this sequence or at different locations very precisely. So this is why the usefulness of this enzyme came into effect. So the next part, how it once the enzyme that we call as the restriction enzyme cuts the DNA, then the question arises that while the defense mechanism in the bacteria, how the host DNA gets protected against this restriction enzyme. Then once we talk about is that the enzymes not only cuts the DNA, it also does some modification. That means the host DNA has been protected by doing some modification appropriately in its DNA molecule. then the further study has done what type of modification this enzyme was actually doing apart from the restriction. So it has been identified that this enzyme methylates, it acts a methyl group at specific bases of the DNA sequence. Thereby it protects and it cuts at the specific location. So this is how a restriction enzyme generally works. Restriction enzymes not only cuts the DNA, but also it will protect the certain sequence of DNA by means of methylation. So this sequences has been very important for characterizing the restriction endonuclease also has been done. So how then, if we go actually a little bit in depth, how the restriction enzyme cuts a DNA? Once we look into it precisely, let's consider an example, a type 2 restriction nucleus. A type 2 is based on the restriction modification system that we will study later on. A type 2 restriction nucleus is generally recognizes and cleaves a DNA molecule of about 4 to 8 nucleotide length. So this of a length of 4 to 8 nucleotide has been identified and it restricts it. And this sequence should be have an axis of rotational symmetry, that it should be a palindrome in nature. So what is mean by a palindrome sequence? If I read from front or if I read from backwards, the sequence will be same, then we call as a palindrome sequence. So generally the restriction enzymes will only cut the DNA which is the sequence is palindrome in nature and it should have a rotational axis of symmetry. So that's why it cuts it. For example, if we studied, let's consider an restriction enzyme that is EcoR1. So EcoR1 can be available in two forms, whether it may be a restriction or EcoR1 or a modification MEcoR1, and it cuts the sequence as you can see in the figure, that is GAATTC. If you study from 5 prime to 3 prime direction or from 3 prime to 5 prime direction, it will be a palindrome in nature, that you can see that GAATCC, and from C you can see it is reversely coming GAATTC. This is called as the axis of symmetry. That means this will precisely help in identifying the sequence and restricting the sequence. So how generally we will represent where it restricts and where it causes modification. So in practically, while we are writing the restriction enzymes, the sequence where it cuts and where it modifies it, it has to be done with a little bit certain symbols. So if you see the symbols, is that the position at which the restriction enzyme cuts is generally denoted by a backslash, and the position which is generally due to a modification of the enzyme, that is the methylation, it is represented by an asterisk symbol. So these two symbols are generally indicated while we writing a restriction sequence. So the back symbols, backslash symbols indicates the restriction site, and the asterisk symbol identifies the modification site. So this you can be seen in the representation in the PowerPoint, that is EcoR1, that is the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. You can see there is a backslash between GAA and an asterisk is between A and T. That means the restriction is going to happen, that is the cutting is going to happen between G and A at the 5 prime to 3 prime direction and upwards, and a modification will happen at A to T. And vice versa, if you see the secondary sequence, that is the 3 prime to 5 prime direction, the same restriction will happen near to the 5 prime direction after the 5 nucleotide CTTAA backslash G, and the modification happens between A and A. So what happens is that this while cut it is going to produce a flanks of two things, that is a sticky ends in nature, that we will study in later on. So this is the cleavage, how it occurs. You can see it, I have put the sequence, that is GAATTC, and its complementary sequence, that is CTTAAG. Once it undergoes, if we put a restriction enzyme, that is the EcoR1, it cleaves into two fragments, as you can see, that is, it produces G in 5 prime direction, then the other nucleotide pass on to the next sequence AATTC, then the G complementary CTTA will be present and another G will be present in the secondary sequence. This is how the cleavage of the E core R1 will happen. So generally it is very difficult to represent the two sequence every time. So this can be simply put it in a simplification of writing in of the representation of this restriction endonuclease. So this can be easily identified only writing on 5 prime to 3 prime direction only. So we can automatically understand what will be there in 3 prime to 5 prime direction. So it is easily denoted for the eco R1, that is G / double A * double TC. It's a simplification of writing of the identification of the restriction engine. So the next part, what we are going to do is how the restriction enzyme is going to cut and what are the different types of ends it is going to produce. So once we study about what are the different types of ends the restriction endonuclease is producing, we understand that while the restriction endonuclease cuts the DNA fragments, it generally produces two types of ends. So one, it is called a sticky end or a cohesive end. That means it is not precisely cutting throughout into two equal parts. Instead of a single nucleotide will be flanking and other nucleotides will be cohesive nature, once I can join, it can rejoin together, as you have seen in E core 1. And second is the type of is called a blunt or flush end. Blunt means it's a precise cutting of the DNA. That means the restriction endonuclease will produce two types of end. One is called the cohesive ends. Second is called the blunt ends. We can call the cohesive or sticky end or blunt or flush end. So let's go through one by one. The first one is the sticky or cohesive ends. E core 1 is a perfect example which produces a sticky ends. As you can see from the figure, that is, you can see the G, C, T, T, A, A. The other side is having a A, A, T, T, C by G. So once I can put the DNA together, it can get reannealed very simply. So generally, while we are working in an rDNA technology, we try to choose a restriction endonuclease which can produce a sticky ends, because it is very easy to handle on the later on stages while joining the DNA with a vector. But if you produce a blunt ends, it becomes little bit difficult, right? So the second type is the blunt or flush ends. So an example is the SMA1, which produces a blunt end, that is CCC/GGG, CCC/GGG. So it produces, as you can see from the figure, it is very precisely cuts it at the CCC GGG in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. So it produces a exact blunt ends, and you can see that it is also a palindrome sequence and it is symmetrical in nature. So while I can put both the type of ends in a single picture, I can see the process of cutting of DNA. So let's consider a chromosomal DNA which is having two recognizing sequence, one for the E core R1 restriction endonuclease and another is for the PVU2 restriction endonuclease. So you know very well that is the E core R1 is an engine which produces a sticky end, as you can see the sticky ends. Then similarly the PVU2 will produce a blunt ends at CAG, CTG, as you can see from the picture. So this is how the two types of ends produced by the restriction endonuclease. That is, one is the sticky ends or cohesive ends, second is the blunt end or the flush ends. So next we will try to understand about the various type of enzymes has been put into a particular classification. So after the discovery of the restriction endonuclease from E. coli, then the research was started going on to isolating the restriction endonuclease from various bacteria, fungi and various cells. So once we collected all the enzymes, we started to put it into a particular classification. So generally Nathans has developed this classification, and it is called as restriction modification system. Simply we can put as an RM system of classification. This system generally comprises of four types. So we can classify all the restriction enzymes into four types, that is type 1, type 2, type 3 and type 2S, based on the nature. Still we have certain enzymes which is not able to put in any of these classifications. Still the research is going on how we can expand this type of taxonomical classification system of the restriction enzymes. So let's consider one by one. So first we'll study about the type 1. So type 1 restriction enzymes is a single enzyme. So single enzymes, but it carries different subunits, and these subunits are used for the purpose of recognizing the sequence 1, second cutting the sequence 2, and third modifying the sequence, that is the methylation. So it generally recognizes and methylates a sequence, but cuts the DNA about up to 1000 base pair away. So I can put in a simple one, that type 1 restriction enzymes or those enzymes are a single enzyme, but it carries different subunits, and these subunits can be used for recognition, second restriction, that is cutting, and third methylation, that is modification. It recognizes and methylates a single sequence, but cuts or restricts up to 1000 base pair away. This is the, if any enzymes were having these characteristics, was generally put into the type 1. In the type 2, you can see it is two different enzymes, which both the enzymes parts will recognize the same target sequence, which is symmetrical in nature. That means it is two enzymes, but both enzymes has a characteristics to recognize it, but the sequence should be symmetrical in nature, and both the two enzymes either cleave or modifies the recognizing sequence. That means the two enzymes, one either can cleave or modifies the recognizing sequence. So in type 1, as you have studied, it's a single enzyme but have different subunits. But in type 2, it is two enzymes. These two enzymes both can recognize the target sequence, but the sequence should be symmetrical in nature. In this two enzymes, either it can cleave or modify the sequence. So this is about the type 2 classification. Once we study the type 3, type 3 is similar to type 1. It is also a one enzyme with two different subunits. In this, in type 1 we have different types of subunits will be present, but in type 3 it will be only two subunits will be present in a single enzyme. One subunit is for recognition and modification, and one is for cleavage. That means in type 3 it is a single enzyme, carries two subunits. One subunit will be for recognition and modification, and another subunit for cleaving. But it can recognizes and modifies, but cleaves up to 24 to 26 base pair away. So this is how the type 3 works. Then if you see the fourth one, that is the type 2S. So the type 2S is similar to that of the type 2 enzyme. Like type 2 enzyme, the type 2S is also a two different enzyme, but recognizes sequence which is asymmetric in nature. If you see the type 2, which is a symmetrical sequence only, it can be identified. But in this case, it is type 2S. The asymmetric sequence has been identified by both the two different enzymes, and cleave occurs on one side of recognizing sequence up to 20 base pair away. That is, it cuts up to 20 base pair away from the recognizing sequence. These are the four basic classification of the restriction modification system, that is type 1, type 2, type 3 and type 2S. So next comes, after identification of so many types of restriction enzymes, and most of the restriction enzymes has been used in developing the rDNA gene for the production purpose or genomic library purpose, then there should be a nomenclature. So the nomenclature will be helpful to identify the source, and also will be helpful the nature of the enzyme. So let us study about the how the nomenclature has been given to restriction endonuclease. So after this discovery of the large number of restriction enzymes, there should be a need of an uniform types of nomenclature. So Smith and Nathans in 1973 has developed this nomenclature system. A simplified version is currently available today. So the key features of this nomenclature, if you can see, the key feature is that we can find the host organism in which it has been isolated and which type of enzyme is as per the restriction modification system. So if you see the nomenclature, the first letter will be in capital and it denotes the genus name of the host organism, right? The next two letters will be denotes the species name, and this first letter, that is the genus name in capital, and the next two letters, that is of the species name, generally in small letter. So these three letters has been abbreviated and it is generally written in italics. Then the fourth letter identifies the strain. For example, in ECO-R1, the R will identify the strain, and the final one, that is the Roman numerical, identify the order of identification of the particular host organism. This we can explain a little elaborately with an example of the our own ECO-R1. So you can see the abbreviation E stands for the genus name, it is Escherichia. Then the CO stands for the species name of that E. coli, that is the coli. So ECO will be written in italics. Then the capital letter R indicates the strain from where the restriction enzyme has been isolated, that is the strain was RY13. Then the Roman letter 1 indicates it was the first enzyme has been identified from that particular host. So thereby we can tell that it is an ECO-R1. So apart from this, there are certain prefixes has been added to the nomenclature. These prefixes based on the characteristics of the restriction enzyme. So if an restriction endonuclease encodes an intron, then it should be prefixed with I. For example, you can see ICEU1, or intin endonuclease has been prefixed with PI. That is PIPSP1 for an example. Sometimes if it is doing a restriction or modification activities, then it can be prefixed with RRM, for example RECOR1 or RMECOR1 or RSMA1 or MSMA1. So these are the how the nomenclature has been done. So in my next slide, you can see different types of restriction endonuclease, some examples which is available in the market for cutting the DNA. So for each restriction endonuclease, you can get from various vendors who can supply with the precise DNA sequence. It can do the restriction modification system. So I have put an example. You can see certain enzymes with 4 base cutters, 6 base cutters and 8 base cutters with the recognizing sequence. So it will be helpful for you for the further studies. So I think this lecture has been very helpful for you and understanding all the basic things about the restriction endonuclease. I thank you very much for your continuous support. I will assure you that in my future lectures, you can study the next steps of the rDNA technology, like gel electrophoresis, southern blotting. So I will thank you very much for your support, and I will request you to continually listen my lectures in future. Thank you very much.